Greetings, dear aspirants. Welcome to today's current affairs session on Civilspedia. Today, we'll be discussing about the intangible heritage of India, about the Kusum scheme, about e-Aushadhi portal, and about Luria Panit under our prelims topic, and about the draft national policy on domestic workers under our mains topic. So let's move on to our first prelims topic of the day, the intangible heritage of India. So under this, you need to know what is meant by intangible heritage and what are the three lists that are maintained by the UNESCO under the United Nations Organization for maintaining or preserving this intangible heritage, and about the Kumbh Mela. So the current affairs is that regarding the Kumbh Mela, because the author has noted that the river Ganges is more cleaner than ever before, even during this Kumbh Mela season. So let's see what is intangible heritage. So we all know about cultural heritage, about the monuments and the collection of objects, which refers to the cultural heritage. So it is all measurable. But the UNESCO has also identified that certain cultural heritage are immeasurable. So they are termed as intangible cultural heritage. So they can be your oral traditions, your performing arts, your social practices, your rituals, festive events, and knowledge and practices concerning the earth and the universe, about the nature, and the knowledge and skills in order to produce the traditional crafts that is seen among many populations in the world. So it will include all your traditions and living in expressions that are inherited from our ancestors and that needs to be passed on to our descendants. So this means your intangible heritage. So in order to preserve this intangible heritage, UNESCO is maintaining three lists. So the first and foremost list is this representative list of the intangible cultural heritage of humanity across the world. And it also maintains the list of intangible cultural heritage which is in need of urgent safeguarding. And also there is a register for good safeguarding practices that is being followed across the countries of the world in order to preserve this intangible heritage. So you need to know something about UNESCO which maintain this representative list. So UNESCO is nothing but the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization, where its headquarters is located in the city of Paris, France. So this UNESCO seeks to build peace through international cooperation in the field of education, sciences and also the culture. Hence, this will be part under the UNESCO. So the UNESCO's programs contribute to the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals where we have an agenda of 2030, which was adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in the year 2015. So this you need to know about UNESCO. And UNESCO has also been in recent current affairs because the countries United States of America and Israel have pulled out of their membership from the UNESCO because they have cited as an anti-Israel bias, because UNESCO is one of the first organizations to recognize the state of Palestine, and which Israel and US oppose. So in line with that, UNESCO recognized a disputed site in the state of Palestine as an intangible heritage site. So Israel vehemently opposed this and it pulled out of its membership. So US also followed Israel, and now as of now, both of them are not members of UNESCO. So the importance of UNESCO is very relevant even now. So let's see the representative list of the intangible cultural heritage of humanity, one of the three lists that is maintained by the UNESCO. So the sites, there is no site which needs urgent safeguarding, or there is no site where best safeguarding practices are carried out, especially in the country of India. So we have some sites under the representative list of the intangible cultural heritage of humanity. So starting 2008, many sites are under this list. So in 2008, Kudiyattam Sanskrit theater in the state of Kerala, and the tradition of Vedic chanting and Ram Leela, which is the traditional performance of the Ramayana, were brought under this representative list. And 2009 year, Ramman was recognized, which is nothing but the religious festival and the ritual theater of the Garhwal Himalayas, especially in the state of Uttarakhand in the Himalayan states. And in 2010, Chau dance, which is being celebrated across some of the states of eastern India, and Kalbelia folk songs and dances of Rajasthan, and Mudiyettu, ritual theater and dance drama of Kerala was recognized and put up under this list. And in the year 2012, the Buddhist chanting of Ladakh, especially in the Himalayan states of Jammu and Kashmir, was brought up under this list. In the year 2013, we had Sankirtana, which is a ritual singing, which also involves drumming and dancing from the state of Manipur, which was put up under this list. And in the year 2014, the traditional Tateras of Jandiala Guru in the state of Punjab, India, where they make the traditional brass and copper craft of utensils, was recognized under the list. In the year 2018, Navruz, it is being represented in different names across different nations. So it is nothing but the New Year of the Muslims. So this was collectively brought in the year 2016. And yoga was also put up under this list in the year 2016. So the final entrant is Kumbh Mela, which was put up in the list in the year of 2017, almost towards the end of 2017. So this is the new entrant. So this is also very much relevant under this particular topic. So you need to know something about Kumbh Mela. So Kumbh Mela is the largest religious gathering in the world in order to do their own religious rituals. So they come and take a holy dip in the rivers. So Kumbh Mela is celebrated once in 4 years across four different sites. So the first one is the Haridwar. First one is the Haridwar, and second is Ujjain, Nashik, and fourth one is the Allahabad. So the Ganges, Haridwar, the river Ganges flows, and in Ujjain the river Shipra flows, and in Nashik river Godavari flows. And Prayag is the confluence of the rivers Yamuna, Ganga, and the mythical river Saraswati. So people take a holy bath once in every 4 years in these sites. So this is all you need to know about the Kumbh Mela, which will be useful for your prelims topic. So just remember those four sites that are associated with Kumbh Mela. Let's move on to our next topic, Kusum scheme. So you need to know, this is a social sector scheme, basically a social sector scheme brought by the central government. So you need to know about the ministry, who are the beneficiaries under this particular scheme, and what is the impact area of this scheme. Because the proposal was Kusum scheme was tabled by the government in the parliament. So this scheme name is an acronym of Kisan Urja Suraksha Evam Uttan Maha Abhiyan. So Urja Suraksha, Kisan is farmers, and Urja is energy, Suraksha is protection. So it aims to give a sense of energy protection to the farmers and to expedite in the area of energy. Evam Uttan Mahabhiyan is to expedite in the area of energy in order to bring some source of revenue to the farmers. So it just means that. And this particular scheme has been formulated by the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. So this particular scheme is currently under the process of getting approval. So who are the beneficiaries under the scheme? They are nothing but the farmers, because the name itself denotes that Kisan, farmers. And impact area is the power, nothing but the energy. So it aims to use the solar energy, tap the solar energy to benefit the farmers. So the farmers will be relieved of their energy or power requirements in order to cultivate the field. So basically they need water. For water, they need to pump the water from the underground level or from the wells. So for that, they need power. Right now, power across different states is heavily subsidized, and there is also unavailability of power in some of the states. In order to overcome this, the government aims to install the solar plants in these fields in order to aid the farmers. So once they'll be self-sufficient, they would also be able to sell the extra power to the connected grid, the national electric grid, so that they'll also have some source of income from the power generation. So this is one thing, and the government also aims to have some power generation on a smaller scale at all the in all the states. So the construction of these solar plants will be only on the infertile land, so that the fertile lands will be left untouched. And distribution of solar power pumps and power generation from tube wells is also expected. And the sale of excess power generated would be taken care by the government. So all these forms the features of this particular KUSUM scheme. And the, under this components, so they have planned to distribute the solar pumps. So they will be working towards this distribution. And they have also planned to construct the solar plants on infertile lands. So they'll be expediting this construction of solar power factories. And they'll also help in setting up the tube wells and also modernizing the present pumps that are in agriculture fields of the different states. So some budget will be allocated for this scheme and will be expedited by the government. So you just remember what is the ministry of the scheme and which area it is actually impacting. So it is impacting the power and the beneficiaries are the farmers. So just have this in mind. Let's move on to our next topic, e-Aushadhi portal. So under this topic, you need to know what is the purpose of this particular portal and which ministry is handling this particular portal, because we'll come to know there are some differences between e-Aushadhi and your Aushadhi stores. So the Ayush minister has launched the e-Aushadhi portal for online licensing system of Ayush medicine. So this particular Aushadhi, e-Aushadhi, is an acronym for Ayurveda, Unani, Siddha and Homeopathy Automated Drug Health Initiative. So these are some other alternative forms of medicine apart from the regular allopathic medicine. So this portal will help towards organizing these licensing activities by making it online, for especially for the Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani and Homeopathy drugs. So this is an initiative of the Ministry of Ayush. This particular portal, there are some advantages towards implementing this particular portal. So it will increase the transparency, it will improve the information management facility, because right now the information management is highly disrupted. So this will unify the information management, and it will also help them improve data usability, and it will help them increase accountability and the end. So these are the advantages of using this e-Aushadhi portal for the benefit of these alternate medicine department. So this portal, this particular portal is different from your PM, Pradhan Mantri Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana, because this comes under your Department of Pharmaceuticals under your Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. So one is likely very easily to get confused, because e-Aushadhi portal pertains to the Ministry of Ayush, and your Aushadhi Yojana, Aushadhi Pariyojana, will come under the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. So be clear in this particular topic. Let's move on to our next topic, Luria Funit. So the keywords under this is a particular festival. So you need to know this, where, in which state is this particular festival celebrated, and something about the Nagas, the tribes which celebrate this festival. So the tribes that celebrate this festival is the Tangkul Nagas. So we'll also be looking at these Tangkul Nagas. So the news, the recent current affairs is that some 2000 people of this particular tribes, the Tangkul Nagas, are located in the metropolitan city of Chennai. So they have celebrated this particular festival. So we need to know what this particular festival is. So Luira, Lui plus Marra. So this is field and this is digging. So it denotes that this festival name itself denotes that it is something related to digging the field. So this is being known in the Tangkul language, which is being spoken by these Tangkul Nagas. So it means that it is some form of seed sowing festival in order to start their agricultural practices. So which is being celebrated as a festival by these Tangkul Nagas in the northeastern part of India. So this is a very important festival of Tangkul Nagas. And as I told, it is a traditional seed sowing festival. So not just doing this digging activity, but they also celebrate it in the form of songs, dance and also eating food. So celebrated festival associated with this eating is the pork eating festival that is also being celebrated under this Luira Funit. So you need to know something about the Tangkul Naga. So they are the major Naga ethnic groups who are living in the Indo-Burmese border area. So they are also located in some of the areas in the Manipur state of India, and also in the adjoining area in the country of Myanmar, or also the erstwhile Burma. So in India, they are located in the Ukrul district in the state of Manipur. And basically, this particular tribe is an egalitarian society. So they do not have any castes or caste-based groups amongst them. And they follow a patriarchal system. And now they have majority of this population has started to follow the Christianity religion. So this religion is very much prevalent amongst these tribal groups. And the language that they speak is the Tungkul dialect. So this you need to keep it in mind with respect to these tribes called the Tungkul Nagas. So this is all you need to know about Luira Funit. So just remember, even though they are Nagas, this festival is being celebrated in the state of Manipur. Let's move on to our main topic, the draft national policy for the domestic workers. So as of now, the government is not having a clear-cut law to address these domestic workers concerned in India. So now they are the Ministry of Labour and Employment is planning to come up with a draft national policy on these domestic workers. So it is very much under the draft stage and it was informed by the minister in the parliament. So they have also put up these draft national policies. So we will just see what are some of the components of these draft national policy. So this policy basically aims to bring in some sort of legal security to these domestic workers. So they are not even recognized as unorganized workers as of now legally. So this draft policy will aim to recognize them as the unorganized workers. So they will have the inclusion of domestic workers in the existing legislation. So in whatever legislations where formal employment is under which the formal employment option is being taken, so they'll also be included under this. And the domestic workers will have the right to register as unorganized workers, and it will actually able to facilitate their access to rights and benefits. So along with this, they also are planning to give right to these domestic workers to form associations and unions. And they will also give the economic security. So this economic security in the form of minimum wages and access to social security as well. So we'll also be seeing some components of social security. So they will also be given the right to enhance their skills, meaning the state or the center will take initiatives towards improving the skill of these domestic workers. And they'll also have the protection of from the abuse and the exploitation. So this will also be ensured by the policy. And the domestic workers to have access to courts, tribunals for grievance redressal. So this is a formal legal option in order to address their grievances. And establishment of a mechanism for regulation of private placement agencies will also be taken up under this draft national policy, because right now domestic workers are largely exploited by these private placement agencies and they are subjected to innumerable abuse. So this would be taken care by setting up a mechanism under this policy. And they are also planning to establish a grievance redressal system for the domestic workers apart from your regular legal route. So these are some of the components of this draft national policy for domestic workers. And now there are also some other statutes that are indirectly covering these domestic workers domain. So one is the Unorganized Workers Social Security Act of 2008. So it aims to provide the formulation for the social security schemes, like covering their life and disability and covering their health and maternity benefits and also covering their old age protection. And if you see the statutes under the state governments, so they are mandated to formulate the suitable welfare schemes related to all these components. So one is your provident fund, employment, injury benefits, housing, on the education schemes for the children of these domestic workers, and the skill upgradation of workers, financial assistance, and also to the old age homes of these domestic workers. So this is all at only the statute level, or not even at the inception level. So a lot needs to be done towards improving the social status of these domestic workers, because they comprise almost 40 lakh of the entire 120 crore population of India. And some of the state governments have included these domestic workers under the Minimum Wages Act. So all the South Indian states, the four South Indian states of Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh excluding Telangana, and the states of Jharkhand, Odisha, and the three states Rajasthan, Haryana, Punjab, and also the northeastern state of Tripura have included the domestic workers under this Minimum Wages Act. So under this act, the domestic workers are entitled to file case before the concerned authorities in case of grievance in these regards. So if they're not getting the minimum wages as promised, they can go for legal solutions. And also, there is something called State Domestic Worker Board. So this particular constitution of State Domestic Workers Board is under the jurisdiction of the state governments. So this was all the matters that was informed by the minister in the parliament. So, and it has been put up in your PIB. So with this, we are winding up our today's topic. Please do like, comment and share the video. And please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.